So good morning for the people who are with hangover. I'm sorry because it's a bit late, early in the morning. I think it's going to be more like a friendly talk because I nearly know most of the faces. That's really great. So what I'm going to talk about is Plone 5. Who does not know what's Plone? One person? Well, that's great. There is one person. So then I finish the talk and I go to take some beers. So let's go to try to do that. Who am I? I'm Ramon Navarro Bosch. I'm a Plone Foundation member. I'm in the framework team in Plone. That's the core Plone team that's doing, it's meeting every week. It's really boring. And then there is the I'm a CTO at a company in Catalonia. And yeah, I'm Catalan. So that's who am I. You can see my shirt, but I'm Catalan. So how I'm going to organize this talk, I'm going first to talk about Plone 5, because we are now in a good moment in Plone. We are going to release Plone 5. So I'm going to try to explain you what's going to change there and how you're going to program there. And then I'm going to talk about machine learning, because otherwise you cannot include your talk in EuroPython. So let's talk about Plone 5, so from the user point of view, from the developer point of view, from the CTO point of view, from the business point of view, it's mostly quality, user interface, testing. It's a really old software. We have nearly 12 years that's been there. We grow really fast. We have a lot of sites around the world, for example, the Brazilian government. And it's really being used a lot on big companies, ABB, some other big companies are using that. So, and why they are using? Because it has a good quality, it's really stable. You can grow from a really small site that it's only for your personal usage, for your shop under your flat, or you can just use the same software for building really a big site, or a weak internet, or big content management system. So. Everybody knows Plone, so that's going to be a bit boring because I'm going to talk about what's Plone from the user point of view. So Plone from the user point of view is content. Content is the king. That's the king in Japanese. So what does it mean? That everything is content-oriented. It's you have pages, you have documents, you have folders, you have events, you have whatever you want. For example, there is an hospital in my city that they want to store the patient sheets about, okay, he's ill, he has these problems, we solve that. This is content, everything that's a piece of a document that we can have in a Word or an Excel or whatever, or we can have in a piece of text is a document. So content is the king, content is the center of Plone. And we have full multilingual support. And in Catalan also, so that's great. It's translated in more than 50 languages. I added this because most of the CMSs that we have in other languages like Java, I think, or something like that, doesn't have full multilingual support. That means that all the content can be translated to all the languages and you have connection between one translation to the other, blah, blah, blah. Okay, one of the most important things about Plone is the security. Why is being used by FBI? Why is being used by the Brazilian government? Why is being used by ABB? It's because they know that it's really secure, so all the content that's there, all the fields, everything that's there is not going to be seen by anybody that you don't want that is seen. And why is because we have this security granularity? It's because we have DOPE and ZODB. I'm going to talk a bit about that later. And we have workflows. So all the content goes through different steps, and in each step has different permissions for different users, groups, etc. Theming. If you were using Plone before Plone 5 or Plone 4, you will surely quit using Plone because it was really difficult to use, the curve of entrance. I've been asking some of the EuroPython people, have you used Plone in the past? Yeah, but I quit it because it was so difficult to understand. So what we solved with that? We solved most of the problems that we had with the theming, for example. Now we are using some kind of rules we call the ASO. They are designed so you can theme your site without knowing anything, neither about Python if you want. It's using rules to move things from one from place to the other. Later I'm going to show. Ah, yeah, we integrated require JS and less. So if you want to build a nice front end with Angular or with React or whatever, Plone directly provides you the tools that you need to do that. We have inline edition through the web edition, so you can see in the back, you can create content, move content around. This is Mosaic project, is one spin-off of Plone that's still a work in progress. It's really cool because you can just create content, you can just upload an image through the web with a drag and drop and push it wherever you want in the page. Okay, if you want, we can try. Let's see. So this is the new Plone 5 front end. It's really cool because it's using a theme called Barceloneta. Barceloneta from Barcelona, Catalonia again. thank you. Just, you can see, I think it's in English, yeah. So there is some kind of cool things you have. You can browse all your content here. This resolution is not really good for doing these kind of things, but you can go to the folders. You can go to the content and see whatever you have here. I didn't create it. You can create a new page wherever you want and just write down whatever you want. You have this tiny MC4 that's really cool. So you can push images, you can push files, whatever, and save it. Okay, so then you can go to contents, and there is a lot of good features that if I would show that, we will still until tomorrow. So just sharing, you can decide who can edit, who can, the history button, where you can see who edited, which is the difference, et cetera, et cetera. Yeah, okay. So now, as we are in a technical conference, I'm going to talk a bit more about how it's technically Plone, because that was like the commercial screencast, so let's go. Hierarchy. The Plone is based on a hierarchy database because as all the users are used to have their desktops with folders, contents inside that, so we are using a specific database, it's called ZODB. It's really, I think right now, ZODB has more than 10 years, maybe. More than 10 to 12 years, okay. So, and at that time, nobody was talking about non-SQL, and ZODB is a non-SQL database that you store objects inside objects, and he stores directly the pickles on a really great structure. So if you want to, if you are not going to use Plone, but you need some kind of database that you need to store a tree of objects that are going to have some kind of relation between them, ZODB is a really great database outside of Plone also. So this concept of storing everything in a hierarchy mode, it's really, there is no other CMS that does that. Everybody is storing things in SQL data, but content management is not relational data. If you go to university and you say, oh, I'm going to store an object and I'm going to put all the HTML in a field of my table, sorry, you need to structure that, you need semantical, you need to have the option to have sons of your content. You have a folder, then you have a content inside that, images inside that. So that's one of the main points that technically talking. But the content is the king. We have this folder structure. So then what are we using to have the content? We are using a project, it's called Dexterity in Plone 5. We remove the archetypes. If you never use archetypes, I'm really sorry for you, but Dexterity is a really cool piece of software because it allows you to create defined content. With a simple interface. Just you decide, okay, I want to create a content, it's called a sponsor. And then you have a choice field where you can have different vocabulary, a little vocabulary that's going to be shown from the UI. You have a rich text, that means it's a tiny MC, it's going to render a tiny MC so you can write down. You can define a URI, you can define different kind of fields, files, images. You can define also permissions for specific fields. Okay, I want that Timo doesn't see that field, so I can write that Timo will not see that field. That's really cool. So with this simple file, there is no copy strange thing that we used on our types. That only defines really the interface, really the fields that you want on your content, the semantical meaning of your content. You can define your own content type. Then this content type, it's going to be mapped to the URL. So one of the good things also we have in Zoop, Plone, blah, 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 it's that we have traversal. That means that all these folders that we have, I explained it to you that you have a folder and then a content and then an image, for example, you can access that through the URL. You can write the URL of your site, the folder, the content, blah, blah, blah. And then the view, a specific browser view function that renders that and creates a templating stuff or whatever you want to use to see that. Here we have an example of what's a view. So here we have, okay, let's one of the cool things we added is all this a JavaScript CSS management system. So you register CSS and JavaScript, and then it automatically pops up on your page when it's needed. So you can register, for example, a bundle, jQuery data tables, and you want that this view that's going to render some kind of page has this element, this JavaScript included, and the CSS that's needed for this resource to be loaded. So then you just add resource on request, and you write the name of the resource that you want to add, and it's automatically going to be deployed on your view when you are rendering that. Yeah, there is a lot of technical details. I just don't want to step too much, maybe. Here is how we register a view. I've been asking a lot of people here in EuroPython, what's the worst thing about Plone? And they say, this is XML because it's XML. XML is not bad, sorry. It's okay, it could be better, but this XML is really great because it allows us to have really a good list of the views, the content, all the definitions that we have. So I really think it's great to have this way of defining all the views and all the content. Yeah, and we have the templating. Yeah, because you can create a class to show you the content, to have your content type there, but you need some kind of class to render that on the view page, some kind of templating. And one of the cool things that we added on Plone at the end of Plone 4, it's that we can use Chameleon. So now no more tal, no more way of defining variables with a specific crappy language that's only being used by Zoop. So we can define these variables and use the variables with this dollar stuff there. That's really interesting. So Pythonic, okay, I think that most of you know that. Okay, Zoop is the most Pythonic REST framework for web content management. You can access the object of your site and it's everything mapped to the database, then you can just go to the attribute of your site that's called a folder, and then you can go to the attribute of the folder that's called a document, and then you can access an attribute of the document. So you really have the granularity and the Pythonic way of doing content management. Yeah, I wanted to talk about Zoop component architecture because maybe there has been a lot of talks. The last one I saw that was pushed on the internet, it was 2005, but it's really interesting infrastructure, and it's being misused, I think, because we have Zoop.interface and Zoop.component, that it's really two good packages for managing three good patterns of programming that, okay, if normally when you write some Python code, you write a small program, but if your program is going to grow up, you will need to have some kind of patterns for designing that software. And sometimes there is really good libraries about patterns, how to develop big softwares with that. And Zoop is a really good one. I really love it. So where are we storing our components, our adapters, our patterns? It's in local storage, local registry, and global registry. We have two in Zoop. One is global for all the sites of your environment, of your process, or your thread. And then one specific for each site that's local, the local registry. So I wanted to first explain you, okay, what's an adapter? Adapter, it's the one of the patterns that on software it's really good for using, because we are using in the past like subclassing classes. So we ended having our types that maybe you were looking how many classes it was subtyped, and it was maybe 30 different classes that if you go up to see the parents of the class, you will never know what's going to be there. It was a mess. So we decided, they decided in the community to create this adapter pattern. And it's an interface. You define, in this case, a person. You define some kind of normal interface like Java, like whatever. You define some of the functions and the attributes of that interface. And you have implementations of that interface. For example, we have an interface called iPerson that you define a function, which t-shirt I'm wearing. And then you have an adaptation. It's called Catalan Guy. And then it returns a Estelada. And if there is another implementation, it's called Basque Guy. It serves a t-shirt. So you can use any of these adapters to adapt an object and get the methods that you need. Okay. The subscriber, another kind of good pattern. The observer pattern, the subscriber pattern on software engineering. Okay, we have the kind of object that we want to look. Okay, I want to check if you modify this kind of object. If you modify the iPerson object, then you can subscribe for iPerson, and you want to subscribe for the modified event, and you decide which function is going to be executed in case that's being modified. An utility, okay, that's just, you want to store some kind of list of good alcohol, then you define an interface, good alcohol, and then you have an object that will return all the list of good alcohol because it's an utility. That's really useful. And then at the end, in this more technical about Plone stuff, I'm going to talk about the JavaScript and the CSS integration we did. We created our own kit, our own framework, JavaScript framework. That's the worst error we did, I think, because it's going to be hard to maintain. But okay, at the moment there was no the solutions we have right now on the community of JavaScript. But it was really great. It's using patterns, lib patterns is a way of defining. Okay, you have these elements, and then you can, with data tags on the HTML elements, you can configure them, and they automatically run JavaScript on top of that and renders the correct widget for you. For example, this is the pick a date widget that we have on Plone normally. Then you can see. This is the configuration, you define the format, the date, blah, blah, blah. And everything, it's integrated with required.js and less. That means that if you want, you can start your Plone in debug mode, and then you are going to see everything compiled on time on the browser. So you will see the source code of select tool there. So you can go and debug whatever thing you need. Because when you are Plone, I think that has nearly 1 million of lines of JavaScript with all the libraries that's including TinyMCE is so big that. So if you want to debug that and you don't have the option to really have them uncompressed and that you don't need to take care about loading everything. So we created a Python model that's taking care of that, creating the JavaScript configuration for required.js and compiling less. So you get the source code there on your browser. Diazo, I'm not going to stand on that. It's just a way of defining themes. So you decide, you go to your designer and say, okay, I need to do this web page. So just design that. The designer draws it. You send to the people who does the HTML, and he does the HTML. Okay, the HTML is done. And then you give to the Plone guys, okay, this is the HTML of my site. And with these Diazo rules, you just remove. I want that this deep is this deep of Plone. This piece of here is this piece of here. And you can create your theme without doing so hard integration right now. That's also a really cool thing. Okay, new things that we are working, that we are going to do in the next month, I hope, is the Plone REST API. It's really clear that all the web frameworks, all the web applications are going to move to JavaScript. All the UI needs to be done in JavaScript. So what's really needed is that we have a really cool REST API that we can interact with Plone. So we created Plone Road of REST. I think it's not released, but it's going to be released really soon. You can try it on GitHub. It's really great. We defined a way to define these HTTP verbs like put, get, delete on a specific content type. Okay, I have I person and I want to delete the person. So then I can define a specific HTTP verb for deleting on this object and which is the function that's going to be executed. So here can you see, for example, the implementation of the put. Okay, testing. We improved a lot on testing. We really did a lot of work there. Jenkins.plone.org has the Plone 5 job has 101 acceptance tests, and I think that more than 5,000 more? 9,000 integration tests and unit testing. We really test everything. If you commit something and you break the build, then this guy comes to you and starts to yell at you. And you don't never go to sleep before the Jenkins is green again. So we have really good testing. I really want to thank Timo and the testing team because they really did a great job on that. Because we have really, really, really a good testing environment. So that makes also that the companies rely on us because, we create a new release of Plone and you know that's going to work. Because we have really tested everything. I changed the name of the button of a control panel and have 10 test fields. So that's really, really great. And for companies that rely on that and they want to invest money to get their sites done and the one that in 5 years is still there. So that's really important. So okay, we have Plone 5 beta 3 release now. We created a specific repository, so if anybody wants to try it and he thinks, okay, it's going to be difficult to try Plone because it's a complex software, okay, it's 1, 2, 3, 4 lines of console to try that. You go just clone the github.com Plone jamming 2, you run with Python 2.7, ZODB is already running on Python 3, so we think that we are going to someday to have options to have Python 3 in all the stack. It's really big, so we will try. Then we run build out, and then you run instance fg, and you have your Plone site running. It's only 4 lines of code, 4 lines of console. You need to go to take a coffee between the build out and the instance, because it might take 10 or 15 minutes, or depending on the machine and the network. Okay, we have a really good documentation. There is trainings.plone.org, there is docs.plone.org, hundreds of different doc documentation written for developers and for users, and lots of training. There is a training that it helps you to understand Plone. Okay, the future, we are going to move maybe to REST API, and we need a JSON frontend. We are going to have some kind of a sync IO backend, maybe with SubstanceD, maybe Pyramid, who knows? We will see. We are going to talk about that. But this talk also has at the end machine learning, and they sent me 10 minutes, so I'm going to talk about machine learning also. So what we did in Plone is we created like a proof of concept, because our main goal, the goals that we had of using machine learning is that, okay, the users has used a CMS, so that when you get to the content you want to see, for example, the related content that's on your site, but the people doesn't go to say, oh, this is related to this one, and this is related to this one, because nobody does that in a content management system. So we wanted to create like a smart way of that everything is related between them automatically. Classification of the current content. So if you have your upload site that the people has already target the stuff there, then you want just maybe to run some classification algorithms on top of that to just classify what's new and what's added on your content, on your Plone. Recommendation of subjects and tags. That means that if you are creating a new content and you are editing the content, having a way of user feeling that it's suggesting you, okay, this content talks about that, just asking the user if he wants to tag this content with this kind of subject. And semantic search on the live search, we have a really nice live search, so you can search like in Google and get the content that's there, but it's completely text, only it's looking for text on all the files that we have and all the content that we have, so we're trying to make that it have like semantic search, so it's related to stuff, so it gets more useful. So I started to try to understand what's machine learning. It's completely a big subject. I found one really good picture that I really love and I wanted to show you. This is sklearn map. So you go from a star and say, okay, what I need to do? I need to, I have more than 50 samples. Yeah, in Plone normally you have more than 50 samples. Okay, I want to predict a category. Yes, I want to predict what's talking about. Okay, I have labeled data. No, because people doesn't have labeled data. So. Oh, then we are going to go to yes, but now we go to no. So we know how many categories we have. We don't know how many blocks of content is going to be on the Plone side, but that needs to be defined for the administrator because we are not going to try to predict that. So then we are going to use k-means, and k-means is one of the algorithms that we have implemented, and I'm going to show you if you have had time. Then, in case that we have labeled information, we have another branch. This is a really good scikit spreadsheet that it helps you a lot to decide which algorithms you need to use for different kind of usage. Scikit-learn maybe is not the best option, but we wanted something that is integrated in Plone, and you don't need to run anything else external. There is also we did also implementation with GenSim that works fine, but you need external REST API. You need to export the content, and our clients are really specific about security. So they don't want that we export the content to any other external application. So we need to have everything embedded on the security of SOAP. So we implemented this collective.machine learning in our GitHub. It does clustering. It's one of the initial one. So what we created is an adapter. It's called iLearning string. You get from that adapter, you said this content type is iPerson. And you create this adapter, so this person, I want to get which text I want to use in the machine learning stuff. So maybe you want to join the name, the first name, and his birthday or whatever. And then you create a text line, a text that it's going to be used for analyzing. Then we normalize it, we vectorize with NLTK, with feature hasher that we get the corpus of each document, and we store that corpus on a pickle on the database so we can reuse later, so it's not expensive later to use that. We clusterize, that means that with all the corpus that we have, we created a big matrix of all the things that are on the site. We tried with more than 150,000 documents. Okay, you need 64 gigabytes of RAM or 32 gigabytes of RAM to run that on memory. If you want, you can just use the batch stuff of k-means, but this was running on a single process. We just use memory. There is an algorithm that allows you to have batches, k-mean batch. So we clusterize that. We define the numbers of clusters that we want on the front end, and then we just use the k-means algorithms to decide groups of content. And we store this model, the model that we get on a pickle, on the database, and then we use that model to predict in which cluster is going to be the next content that you create. You create a new content, and then automatically we'll see, okay, this content belongs to this cluster. Yeah. The good thing is that all this implementation has security implicitly because the ZODBs has each object and the catalog is secure. So nobody's going to get any information that doesn't need to be seen by them. And okay, in the future, we are now working with naive Bayes for classification, recommendation, semantic search, and external. We want to be able to extern to push the computation outside of Plone. but it's a bit difficult with a security issue. And I wanted to show you, because they say, oh, maybe I'm not going to believe what you're saying. Okay. So this site has, sorry, it's in Catalan because I was doing this morning, I was a bit sleepy. So, So here I created, for example, some content, a lot of copy-paste content here. And if I go to any content here, I will see that it belongs to cluster one, this side. Let me see, where is my pointer? Yeah. So every there is a sitemap, automatic sitemap, that gets and classifies all my content in different clusters. I'm creating content and it automatically defines the groups of content that are semantically close to that. So how is it configured? It's really nice, this control panel, new stuff. Victor did that there. So let's see it. Yeah, machine learning settings, yeah. So here you define where in the file system are you going to store the beacons. If you want to use an NLTK theme, which are the stop words that you want to use, the different grades that we have. If you want to remember the hashing of the strings on, so they are being stored. And then we define how many clusters we want, the maximum number of clusters, and which is the name of the pickle that we're going to use to store the clustering. And then you can press this compute button, and this compute button, it's getting all the content, processing all the content, steaming all the content, and creating in the catalog of Zoop the specific indexes that will allow us to, in the browser, see which object to which cluster it belongs. And we created this nice view. Yeah, this nice view is called auto sitemap and automatically shows you the content grouped by this kind of cluster. Then it's a matter of each cluster you define what's about. And if you have real content, it's really easy to see that because you see the titles and okay, this cluster is talking about this kind of stuff. So you can name that cluster and the people will see all the content automatically pushed. So this, I'm going to return back to the talk. Yeah, we have a feature on this. This is a proof of concept we are using in production some sites because it was needed, but we are working really a lot on that and we are sprinting on that a lot of time. So if there is any data science people that wants to help us to understand what's going on behind all this stuff, we are really happy that they help us. Okay, Plone community, it's a cool community. If anybody wants to join the Plone community and wants to try now that it's much easier than in the past, you're welcome. We are really cool. And if there is any questions, I'm done.
Thank you for the presentation. Just one question. How does this handle content in different languages?
Yeah, right now the steaming that we have, it uses English and we need to add in the control panel a drop down that allows you to decide which language that you want to use. The steaming is implemented in most of the languages, so it's just a matter of that we add in the control panel this option.
Could you give us a few numbers, how long the computation takes if you have like say 100,000 or a million objects in a CDB?
Yeah, we do that at night, it starts I think at 1 and it finishes at 4, so 3 hours, in 150,000.
Okay, so you most likely have a specific instance for that, so yeah, that does not block the other ones.
We have a specific, the only problem is that when it finishes the computation, it needs to write down on all the objects, the cluster, and that's what takes more. That writing down in all the objects, which is the cluster that it belongs to.
Uh, What's the size once it's done the computation of the pickle on 150,000 documents, and is that read into memory with the sitemap generator on every page request, or do you cache it somehow?
Sorry, I didn't understand.
So what is the size of the pickle that's generated at the end of the computation, and is that read into memory on the auto sitemap on every page request?
No. We are storing the model, and we are storing the vectors modification, the matrix, the corpus. We are storing the corpus and we are storing the model. So we are storing the model because when you create a new content, you want to ask to the model, which is the cluster which it belongs, to store in the attribute.
Yeah.
But and we store the matrix, so if you want to compute some more times, you don't need to recalculate everything, so everything it's can be catched, like if it's not modified. When you are using the site, when you are doing any request, nothing is computed, because everything it's just stored on the catalog and on attributes on the objects.
Oh, okay.
So it's not real-time machine learning. So it's more like we run the algorithms and we integrate with Plone.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Do you have more questions?
Is there something that can do real-time machine learning?
You should talk with some data science.
Okay, because I mean I know like solr or Elasticsearch or things like that, and I don't think that this is possible because it takes some time to build all the indexes, and I guess for machine learning that's the same is true, and then you need incremental indexes and algorithms, so that might be hard to.
I just discovered talking with some data science from from the conference, EuroPython, there is some kind of line of investigation. It's called online. How is it was called? Online learning. Yeah. So that it's are the kind of algorithms that you grow incrementally, and it's designed more for online applications. So we need to investigate that line of usage.
More questions? If not, it's lunchtime. Let's thank the speaker again.
Thank you.
So for lunch.